this program with a special bulletin from the John Doe Radio Show.
Give your new mind.
The human brain is made for thinking, not fumigating. It's hardly a tinker toy or experiment. Not fumigating with drugs.
We talk about marijuana. It's the single biggest drug that is a source of some confusion.
This is really about educating the public about the fact that marijuana is a less harmful drug.
Marijuana, that's to get high.
You can be as high as you want.
The prohibition of marijuana over the last 71 years has not actually prevented you from using marijuana.
You feel weak.
Well, sure to winning the war on drugs.
I do believe there have been some successes.
We will never arrest our way out of this problem.
Welcome to JDR News Live Daily. It is a Wednesday here in the Mile High States, wherever it is, whatever day you're at. Hopefully you're having a fantastic time. Thanks again for hanging out with us here on JDR News Live Daily. Happens Monday through Friday, starting at about 6 o'clock Mountain Time, unless there's possibly something else going on around that time that has to do with cannabis, besides session up and smoking. Haven't had anybody to hang out with me during the show for quite some time now, over a month, so the smoke sessions have been to a minimum, solo dolo smoke sessions, and in fact right now, no smoke sesh, because unless I want to scrape the resin out of my pipe, then we just ain't smoking right now. That's sad. I know you're changing the channel right now, just because I'm not the big ass stoner that you thought I was. It's true, I am a big ass stoner. Sometimes the green kind of falls off. Anyway, neither here nor there. Like I said, hope you're having a fantastic day. Big thanks to the sponsors that make the John Doe Radio Show possible. Weedbiz.net is your place to go to get yourself taken care of when it comes to grow pods. Holler at them. Tell them the JDR sent you. Tell them Michael Hawley sent you. You might even get a bigger discount when it comes to mentioning his name. You can also find out news on Weedbiz.net. Head over there also. Our good friends over at yourgraphics.com helping us take care of the website and making sure that you guys have recorded shows to sit down and listen to. So head to URGRAFIX if you need to get your website redone. You need a WordPress done. You need some advertising, an image for advertising. Holler at them, yourgraphics.com. Make sure you tell them John Doe Radio sent you. And JDR News Live Daily brought to you by USA Cannabis Consulting. Our friends over at USA Cannabis Consulting can help take care of you. If you're looking to navigate the regulatory system, build out something like an actual front room for a dispensary, if you need a concentrate shop, lab, whatever they're calling it nowadays, if you need that built out, they can help take care of you there. Whatever it is. You need somebody who's professional, somebody that knows what they're doing, and somebody who can operate in not only just Colorado, but in other cannabis states. Tell them the John Doe Radio Show sent you. USACannabisConsulting.com. That's where you gotta go. You hear me? Today on JDR News Live, what we're talking about, something that came up late this afternoon. Driver shot on US 85 involved in a Boulder armed robbery. So basically this dude, what he did is went up to Boulder, or these two people went up to Boulder, armed robbery. Someone's missing their stash. Someone's got a big ass black eye and a bloody nose from being pistol whipped. We'll talk about that news story. Dudes ran away, were caught 12 hours later, led police on a high speed chase throughout the north part of the metro here. I'm sure if you're not from Colorado, it doesn't really matter exactly where it was. Just the fact that somebody did an armed robbery and asked for marijuana. Dude said no, pistol whipped. We'll get to it later. Bottom line is, one of the dudes got shot and killed by the popo. Denver seeks to bar new players in medical and retail marijuana. Denver's marijuana regulators have asked the city council, and it's gone to vote one time. Takes two votes for this to go into play. It's going to go into play off the second vote. There's really no way. I don't think that they're going to... Somebody's going to bring in anything to make the city council change their minds on this. But basically, cannabis is a moratorium being put in place for them. So anybody who has a cannabis license right now, whatever it may be, if it's to grow, if it's for a shop, if it's for making concentrates or edibles, if you own one of those licenses, your stock just went through the roof again. I know there was probably a lot of people from across the country, throughout probably the world, that was waiting for this moratorium to end possibly here in Colorado, in Denver. But as I mentioned, probably not going to happen. Don't. And news from California. We talk about San Marcos and our friends in, what was the other one? Did I just lose the page where I had it? We had San Marcos and Newport Beach. There it is. Talk about that here in a minute. They're restricting or eliminating cannabis from that area in California. Cuomo signs two bills speeding up medical marijuana distribution out in New York. New York, a funky, funky place when it comes to weed, because obviously a ton of people smoking out in New York. Laws still ridiculous. It's stupid out there. And you have next door neighbor running for president, Governor Chris Christie, who's absolutely against marijuana and against medical marijuana, from what I can see, implementing rules that are kind of one of those exclusive rules when it comes down to like CBD or the specific plants or specific patients that can get it. Having medical marijuana looking good because, hey, we got medical marijuana in our state, but nobody can get a hold of the damn shiz. I also put in a request to talk to someone from New Mexico. There is a news story out in New Mexico, which we kind of reviewed a little bit yesterday, talking about how access in New Mexico is just ridiculous. I've been talking about this and saying this for a long time, but it just now starting to come into light with a lawsuit that was filed. Patients having to go to McDonald's, patients having to go meet people at Walmart's. Absolutely ridiculous, you know. 10, 20 patients at a time being texted to say, hey, meet me here by their provider. Provider goes and shows up at McDonald's and is dealing legal marijuana, medicinal marijuana from the McDonald's or from Walmart or wherever the hell they meet you. Number one, that person got a lot of marijuana on him. Robbery. Two, the people coming in to get the cannabis, cash only type situation. Robbery. It's kind of ridiculous. So anyway, hopefully, maybe we'll get him in to talk tomorrow. Larry Love, our good friend there in New Mexico, who we've talked to for quite a while. He's always given me the insight on what's going on down there. And if we possibly get to it, weed wars, pro-marijuana groups are fighting against each other. If we don't get to that today, we'll get to it tomorrow. Sonnet. Crazy day here in the Mile High. One of those crazy weather days, I should say, specifically. So, snowing like a blizzard where I'm at last night, just was coming down, and some of the wettest snow that I've seen here in a long, long time. First really big snow that we've had here in Colorado for a minute. Hours into the day, it's already all gone. Roads are clean. No problemo at all. The thing is, it was like a hurricane today here in the Mile High. Freaking wind. If we were to go outside and I were to try and, you know, take a recording of what it actually sounds like outside right now, it would just be like, with wind chimes in the background. That's just kind of how we roll here in Colorado. It's so crazy outside. Molly, the studio dog, sitting here chilling right in front of me, keeping me company, making sure that the show goes all right. I stay on track. She passes out, rolls her eyes, turns around and lays down over there. She won't even go outside because the wind is so windy. So many things banging around outside. She's a rescue dog. And she's been around more and more people here lately. The walks that I take her on, getting a little bit more familiar with her surroundings. Still hates cars. Absolutely hates cars that are driving in the street. And she hates being in vehicles. So she's kind of a scaredy cat. And the wind outside, where I'm getting to, is that she won't go out and take a pizzle or a shizzle. I don't know how she's holding it all day. There's no potty in the house. She goes out there, crawls underneath the deck. I feel horrible for her. I tried going out there. I stayed outside with her for like 15, 30, 20 minutes. just standing there, her staring at me like, why are you torturing me? What are we doing out here? I can't take this. So, I don't know. Either way, last night she went out in the snow and is hopping around like a bunny rabbit, which most dogs do when they're out in the snow. I can't wait till it gets deep enough to where it's a, you know, at her chest level and where she's got a bouncing around left and right, throwing snow around. I don't know. Yet to be determined if she's going to be a snow dog or not. She came from New Mexico. Last year she was born in, like, January. I don't even know if she's seen any snow. Whatever. I just feel bad for her. She'll figure it out. I guess at a certain point where she's about ready to pee her pants, she'll either go pee on the floor, by the door, or run outside, which I'm amazed she hasn't done already. Something else that I had for today, for some reason I haven't pulled it up. I don't have the number specifically in front of me, but as you know, or may not know, July, August. In August, I think it was, is what it was, we raised over $100 million in cannabis taxes here in the state of Colorado. That's between both medical marijuana and recreational marijuana. So record numbers, absolutely massive numbers when it comes down to it. September's numbers fell down just a tiny bit. Probably has something to do. I think it was September 16th we had tax day where you were given a break, a reprieve from some taxes. So that probably had a lot to do with it. People stocking up on that no tax day and then not visiting other dispensaries throughout the month. But definitely a fall in cannabis taxes. Are we worried though? No. It's like I tell people at drug dealers who think they're just super big shiz and that they know the game like crazy, hot shit. Bitch, you don't sell the weed. The weed sells itself. What movie did I hear that from? I can't remember. Either way, it's true. Denver's marijuana regulators are asking the city council to expand rules that would bar any new players from entering the state's largest market for 2 years. A city moratorium aimed at controlling the industry growth has allowed growth. That's that Colorado accent for us. Just leaving out consonants and vowels. I stole it. This bike's number one thing is that we talk weird here in Colorado. Anyway, what the hell am I talking about? Get back to the news story, you bastard. Nobody gives a shit. For 2 years, a city moratorium aimed at controlling industry growth has allowed only existing businesses to open recreational dispensaries, grow houses, or edible manufacturers. That's set to expire on January 1st, a prospect that had eager entrepreneurs and investors lining up, but new proposals submitted Tuesday by Denver's Marijuana Policy Office would extend the moratorium 2 more years. And a newly proposed moratorium would bar any new application from medical marijuana business licensees during the same period. The intent, city officials say, is to hit the pause button and give them more time to gauge the impact of legal marijuana experiment going on. But the scope of the city's proposal caught some marijuana advocates off guard, including at least one, attorney Christian Chris Setterberg. Nobody calls him Christian, who attended a city working group that served as a sounding board. A battle is brewing ahead of a council committee hearing November 24th. Last week, Setterberg helped form the Responsible Cannabis Policy Alliance, which plans to lobby council members. He says, this simply strikes me as protectionism for those industry participants that are pushing for this. And I would agree. You've had 2 years to work this out. Very, very long time to sit down and work this situation out. And it's not like we don't know here in Colorado how things are going to happen and how this dynamic is going to present itself. Specifically, even in Denver. Denver City Council has routinely been anti-cannabis. And the only reason why they've been pro and the only reason why we've moved forward as much as we have here in Denver is because you. Yes, you. Only you. And it's true. If we didn't have the grassroots movement that we do here in Colorado, we didn't have the people that get up and support doing the right thing when these type of things happen, unlike some other places throughout the United States, where it's more of a conservative type situation, or it's a situation to where the people don't speak their minds, or they don't feel like they can speak their minds, or if they just plain don't have the numbers. Luckily here in Denver, we do. And we can find it, kind of fight the city council and fight people on these things. Frustrating, though, how much the city council does have control over the industry here in Denver. And it's frustrating to see businesses and shops, smoking lounges open up surrounding Denver and them get all the attention when it's here in the Mile High City in the Metro Denver, probably some of the highest per capita smokers in the entire United States, literally the highest. It just doesn't work, and it's ridiculous, and it gets to the point, like Sutterberg is saying here, where it starts to become an unfair advantage for the people that have already been in the industry for long, long, long time. But guess that's just how the cookie crumbles. On the positive side, like I said, if you do own one of those licenses, one of these shops, your stock is shooting crazy through the roof. Because it's people that have wanted to come here for years, wanted to do this for their entire life. Throughout the whole history of Prohibition, this idea has, people have wanted to do it. And now that they can do it, they can just pay, you know, to them what they seem like a small amount of money to be able to get one of these licenses. And by no means is it a small amount of money. Hundreds and hundreds of thousands of dollars to million plus dollars to pick up one of these dispensaries or licenses. I mean, it's crazy. It really is. And this type of situation that the city council is creating, limiting other people from coming in, drives up that price even more. On the other side of the moratorium issue are some long-established industry players, neighborhood advocates wary of more expansion, and activists who oppose legalization. Margie Valdez, a Golden Triangle resident. Yo, I have no clue where the Golden Triangle is. I've lived in this state for 32 years, and I have no fucking clue what or where the Golden Triangle is. She's a resident who co-chairs the Planning and Zoning Committee for the Inter-Neighborhood Corporation Group. She applauded the moratorium idea, of course. Soccer mom, scared soccer mom. She also supports city officials' neighborhoods focus proposal to require hearings with more scrutiny for marijuana licenses of all types when businesses seek to start up or change locations. City officials say Denver has reached what they see as a marijuana industry saturation point. I think what we should probably do in marking a certain point as the saturated point of our industry and of any given area is let supply and demand handle that type of situation. That's just me. That's the free market type person in me. And that's probably how it should be for everything across the board. Including hookers. We should have legalized prostitution. Some places may be more heavy and more saturated with hookers than other places. Take Las Vegas, for example. Is there enough hookers in Las Vegas? I honestly don't know. But I would figure that there would be more and 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 more coming there all the time because that's a destination to go get hookers. Either that or East Colfax here in Denver. If you don't want to travel all the way to Las Vegas, you got East Colfax. Point being, that's what people are heading here for. They will decide. If a shop opens up and for some fucking reason the shop can't make it, they lose money, they have to close down, which is unheard of, really, besides being closed down, forced to be closed down by city, municipality, whatever it is. Just like I said at the beginning of the show, bitch, you don't sell weed, weed sells itself. Open up a corner store, coffee shop, whatever it is, and sell some of the shittiest weed out of it. Which, by the way, you technically can't do either one of those things. You can't open up a shop to sell weed, but I don't know if you can necessarily. You can't have people coming in there and it's sitting down. And maybe that's another business model we should start looking into. Coffee and weed. Anyway, I digress. Either way, if a shop closes down because it can't sell enough weed, then that should be the point that we start talking about, do we have too many businesses around? And then even at that, we shouldn't even be talking about it. If somebody wants to go get a business license, doesn't do their due diligence in looking at an area to see if they can have a viable business in that area, that's up to them. They decide they want to go to another spot. They decide they want to open shop here and it doesn't work. It's on them. My opinion is not. At this point, we have proven that cannabis is not going to harm people. It's not going to cause the sky to fall here in Colorado. Although the snow yesterday and the wind hurricane right now, it kind of feels like the sky is falling. But it's not because of cannabis. So I think we've got to that point where we understand what's going to be happening when we introduce these cannabis. So at that point, public safety is now taken off the table. And we should be putting on the table more licenses and more opportunities for these people to come here and open up shop. Period. End of story. The city officials say the city has issued more than 1,000 business licenses that operate in 440 locations to serve the medical and retail markets. Dispensaries of either kind are in 210 places. Ashley Kilroy, marijuana policy director for Mayor Michael Hancock, says the city needs more time to assess the effects of legalization before allowing further growth and could risk overproduction, potentially sending some legally grown marijuana into the black market. I just explain something to you also here for a second about the dang old black market. Some of that weed that's being sold in dispensaries. I saw a news story out today with the West where it talked about how law enforcement officials, you know, have been working out trying to figure out how to catch some of the weed that's being shipped out of here in Colorado. They're saying 90% of what's being shipped is not being caught. And I think that goes for everywhere in the world when you're trying to export some sort of drug. 90% of it is probably not being caught. If you're the unlucky one to be part of that 10% that is actually caught, I'm sorry. But in general, it's pretty quote-unquote easy. I'm not saying I'm going to take my chances of that 10% chance, 90% chance of having it succeed. I'll stick with staying safe on this side of the table. But here's the deal. A lot of that is people coming from out of state, people that have moved here, that have friends out of state, going to go buy at these dispensaries, buying up bulk. A good portion of it is edibles that you can get here that you can't necessarily get in other places, cartridges, concentrate that's not readily available in other places. Sometimes we forget here, and you forget if you're in California or if you're in Oregon or in Washington, that when it comes down to BHO or hash oil, even more so than rosin, because I think rosin, people can go out there, it's a little bit easier it's a little less of a dangerous situation for people to get into. It's just something I could see people in Oklahoma or Iowa or even Florida doing. Then you don't want to end up in a situation like we did here in Denver last week where the dude literally blew the shit out of his house. It's crazy. I haven't heard too much more news about that. In fact, I haven't even seen my get online here in the past couple of days. I'm sure he has been asking for funds for his bail when he finally does get arrested. Although it could be a situation to where he gets arrested and released. Who knows? But you don't want to end up in that situation. So the exportation of concentrates here is probably huge. But getting to the point that I'm trying to make here. People like myself here in Colorado, people like Bike, people that have been in the industry for a long time, that understand paying that 30% tax is something that's just stupid. And if you still have your connects, I don't know, it's not stupid. Sorry, shouldn't call you stupid for paying a tax. We're stupid for putting the 30% tax on it and driving people to the black market. But because people don't want to pay that, they still have their connects for being here for so long, being here since before medical marijuana started for a lot of us, since before recreational started, just a few years into that. You still have people that are growing and producing their own product, whether it be hash caps, the concentrate itself, rosin, bud, whatever it is, there is plenty of access here. And it's fortunate that we're in such a locale where everything's concentrated into just a few areas. You got Colorado Springs, which is its own crazy bastardized version of legalization here in Colorado. Down south, you head up north, northwest, you got Boulder, you got Fort Collins, and then right in the middle of it all, you got Denver and the metro areas that surround Denver. It's not like heading off to California where you may have someone that has a product that's all the way up in Northern California. You're down in Central or Southern California, and you don't necessarily have easy access to that. You still kind of have to look at the postal system or UPS or whatever it is. But fortunately here, a lot of things are within driving distance. I don't know how many times I've drove at least 30, 45 minutes, and that's the extent of having to drive to go get a good product on the black market here in Colorado. Now, I used to live up in Northwest Colorado, and it was about a four-hour drive from here to that corner of the state, which we should just cut that corner where it starts at Craig, Colorado, up to Wyoming, down, and then across over to Utah. Just cut that corner out of the state and toss it off the face of the earth, because it's not really Colorado up there. I know. You have no clue what I'm talking about. Anyway, right next to Steamboat Springs, one of the best places to spend your winter. It's super amazing up there. Puffy, literally, huge snowflakes that happen up there. Such a beautiful place. But anyway, even then, you have people that are driving, like myself, from a rural area, an area out of the way, down to Denver or down to Colorado Springs, and getting basically anything they need. I mean, 4 hours away in Colorado is the farthest that you can drive from Denver to get out of the state. I mean, it only takes 2 hours, 2.5 hours, to get to Kansas from Denver. So either way, you do still have the mountains to navigate. Especially during the wintertime, that can be a bit of a pain in the ass. And if you don't have chains this year, you could end up with like a $225 ticket. On every car has to have chains, because they're so sick of people driving that don't know how to drive in the mountains and spinning out, causing crashes. And then you're waiting in line for like 6 to 8 hours coming back from skiing. Wow, got off kind of a tangent there. Sorry about that. Everybody's like, I do not give a shit about what you're talking about. Get back to the news. But the notion Denver has reached a saturation point divides Colorado marijuana businesses. What you're doing is the city and county is picking winners and losers in the industry, says Tyler Henson, president of Colorado Cannabis Chamber of Commerce. By continuing the moratorium, it's saying that there's something wrong with the industry, which there's not, and it's boxing out those who want to get into the industry. Exactly what I just said. Striking a different note in the marijuana industry group, which also represents some business owners, its statement Tuesday said its leaders still were evaluating proposal details. Although Executive Director Mike Elliott said market demand should drive expansion, he quickly added the marijuana industry has helped spark an economic boom in Denver. But at this point, it appears the number of businesses is in line with market demand. Like I said, I don't think anybody that's able to open up a cannabis shop is going to go out of business at this point in time. It's not going to happen. Even if your weed is the swaggiest of swag and bunk, I mean, you're going to be able to get rid of it. There's going to be people out there that come and buy it. Like we've talked about before, 90% of people that smoke weed are custies. And they don't give a shit what they smoke out of. They don't give a damn what they're actually smoking. And if you try and teach them something about good cannabis, about why there's better products out there for the price that they're paying, or where these products are out there for the price that they're paying, they don't want to listen to you. They don't give a damn. I mean, it's crazy. So when you sit down to think about why certain things kind of still exist, it's because you are in the minority. Assuming you're not a custy. You could be a custy. I don't know. There's nothing wrong with being a custy, I guess. Oblivious to the world around you. Doing your own thing. Chris Sederberg said... Oh, by the way, something else that's funny, too. Yesterday in the news... Number one, I'm seeing more and more... down the middle news reporting when it comes to cannabis. Cannabis not necessarily being blamed for certain instances to where people are robbing, like we talked about yesterday with the dude that was found dead in the burnt car. And he was part of a growing operation gone bad. Had been shot in the legs, shot in the chest, and then shot in the jaw. Driven 100 miles away, car lit on fire and burned. And then today, talking about the dude who got robbed in Boulder and pistol whipped here in a second. We'll get to that. These stories, usually in a lot of places, the headline, first thing you see is marijuana. And it's like, oh, God. Facepalm. Now we got to deal with this. But fortunately, at least with the Denver Post, 9 News, Channel 7, CBS, still a bunch of shitmongers when it comes down to it. Horrible news agency here in Colorado. And really, it's for the older people. CBS 4, it seems like. It's like pitching to the older generation of peeps here in Colorado. It's good to see, though, that they're putting more blame on the actual people who decide to do these stupid things and not just marijuana itself. One of the largest comic book stores in the entire world is here in Colorado. It's called Mile High Comics. And in a news story yesterday, the guy talked about how he was selling his big-ass warehouse. He has two of them. And he's turning one into a big-ass store. And I'm telling you, there's like 6 million comics stored away in this guy's spot, along with tons of other collectibles. Altogether, him saying like 16 million pieces of memorabilia in the collection, selling that warehouse that he has for millions. A couple million dollars, over four times what he bought this for. And contributing everything in the news story to cannabis, saying it's been so awesome that we have weed pushing the economy here in Colorado, lifting people up that otherwise wouldn't be able to get out of situations. Who's going to buy a warehouse that holds 6 million comics? Now, granted, the comics aren't going to be there, but this old warehouse, downtown Denver, the Santa Fe Drive area, even all the antique shops on Broadway. Talk about Broadsterdam here. There used to be just a ton of antique shops, and they slowly closed over the years as antiques kind of started becoming a phased out thing with a lot of people. Older generations, really some of the only ones that collect antiques. I know you're saying, I love antiques. But it did. It fell off quite a bit, and that part of town, that street, had empty buildings as far as you could see. And then the cannabis rush came in, and shops started filling those buildings, taking up warehouses throughout Denver. I can't remember what I think it was like 1 in 3 warehouses in the Denver metro area are now growing cannabis. Not exactly sure on that number. I think that's what I saw. But either way, for people that are possibly stuck in a rut, can't sell their business, can't sell their building, cannabis has been a savior for them. By the way, also in that story, the dude that owned Mile High Comics talking about he didn't just name Mile High Comics because he's in the Mile High City. Dude was a huge stoner when he was in college, opened up Mile High Comics, and years later, selling off his one building to make a massive profit off of cannabis. It's a beautiful story. It really is. It's one thing to hear of people that didn't have anything to do with cannabis, didn't support what we're doing here in the cannabis industry. For them to succeed, that's great. I applaud them also, because you can put them in with the figures and the percentages that we're working with as success stories. But it's ultra, ultra awesome and so cool to see people that have been invested in cannabis, been cannabis smokers their entire life, now profiting and succeeding because of the cannabis industry. It's makes me so proud. Almost brings a tear to my eye. Such a fantastic thing. I'm so happy for you, man. Come here, give me a hug. Molly's looking up like, dude, what the fuck are you doing? What's up, doc? Go back to sleep. It's okay. How she sits there most of the time without looking up at me like I'm a jackass for talking to myself for an hour, hour and a half, I have no clue. I wish I was a dog. Zetterberg took issue with the statement that businesses are in line with market demand. He said his policy alliance group includes established businesses, marijuana advocates, and people who have spent money on plans for prospective businesses in anticipation of Denver opening up its market in 2 months, not closing it to them for longer. Extended moratoriums would offer the only chance for major expansion to the holders of about 85 eligible medical marijuana licenses that, according to Kilroy, haven't been converted or expanded into the recreational side. Another frustrating part is that, like it just said, those people that have medical marijuana licenses can't convert those and can't do anything to expand their business and flip over to recreational. And there are some activists here in Colorado and probably throughout the nation who absolutely deplore, they hate legalization because of that 30% tax. And here's my theory on cannabis patients who don't enjoy legalization. My theory, and it goes hand in hand with kind of like why some people are racist and why some people don't want, why conservatives feel the way that they do about some things, why people don't want change. It's because the majority of these people, and I'm giving them the benefit of the doubt here, that they're not just shitty people or just people with wrong ideas, however you want to get down to it, but the fact that these people don't want to lose what they already have. That they think if another group is allowed to come in and use it with them, be a part of the organization with them, use the same benefits with them, they think that their benefits are going to mean less. And I'm going to get shoved out. This can't happen. This is absolutely horrible. And maybe that's my, I don't know, first time today I haven't been able to think of the goddamn word I'm looking for. Maybe that's me just being too hopeful and too positive on the situation. Especially when it comes to the tying in the racism issue into this is, you know, you're just scared. You're just scared that you're going to lose something. You're not going to lose anything. Trust me. Not going to lose anything. In fact, your market is going to be expanded. You're going to have more options. More ability to get out and do what you want to do or get the product that you want to get. In this instance, talking about cannabis. So, I don't know. Maybe I'm wrong for bunching racist people and activists who just want to keep medical marijuana. Not have recreational marijuana. Maybe that's wrong, but still, I attribute them both to the same thing. Don't want to lose what they already have. Or they just hate you. Where's my water at? If you got anything in the chat, if you're with us live here on JDR, which I'm not sure how many people are actually watching us live throughout our shows that we do. It's very few compared to the people that download the John Doe Radio Show and get us from our website, johndorad.io. johndorad.io, all our recordings on there, everything we've ever done, including the recordings with Michael Hawley, who I keep asking to come on these shows. I keep hollering at him, say, hey, I can call you. Call you, buddy. I haven't got an exact response from him yet, so hopefully he wants to join us here soon. Before we actually get into a brand new studio, because I have no fucking clue when that's going to happen. If you got any questions or comments, just holler at me in the chat, youtube.com/JohnDoeRadio. Otherwise, enjoy the recording. San Marcos City Council unanimously approves medical marijuana ordinance. I would much rather listen to something than I would watch a YouTube video. Number one, I can usually multitask if I'm listening to a podcast, say like the Joe Rogan Experience or something like that. I hate looking at myself on this stupid video. Number one, it's this non-HD webcam hooked to my computer. And then I'm kind of self-conscious about my looks. So I'd rather just listen. And to me, it just sounds so much better when you're just listening. Whatever. You don't care. As long as you get your news and information right. I guess that's all that matters. North County City Council took steps against, again, to keep medical marijuana dispensaries out of the community. Talking about San Marcos here, the City Council. On Tuesday evening, the City Council members unanimously approved introduction to an ordinance that would prohibit cultivation, delivery, and sale of medical marijuana. Decision comes in anticipation of the bill signed by Governor Jerry Brown regulating cannabis in the state. Recently, Governor Brown signed a trio of bills that would regulate medical marijuana in California. The bills established the first statewide licensing and operating rules for pot growers, manufacturers of cannabis-infused products, and retail weed outlets since California voters legalized medical marijuana in 96. However, under the state regulations, cities have until March 2016 to establish their own legislation for medical marijuana sales, including booting them out, banning sales, banning grows, banning any type of cannabis in their area. San Marcos had already banned medical marijuana dispensaries back in 2006, but the city council once again voted on placing a ban in anticipation of next year's deadline. Meeting was lighthearted. Despite the subject, council members addressed concerns about medical marijuana sales, including mobile marijuana dispensaries. There was no opposition to the ordinance from the public present at the county meeting. So, that's a big shame on you, cannabis people. Advocates, not one single person showing up to fight this. So that type of situation happens, it's gonna obviously go through. It's just like a court ruling. You don't show up for court, guilty, judgment against you. Do not pass go. Do not collect $200. There was no opposition to the ordinance, as we said. San Marcos is not the only local city taking steps to prohibit the sales of medical marijuana. El Cajon also voted on Tuesday to continue with the process of keeping dispensaries out of their city. And Newport Beach ordinance will ban growing and sales. Marijuana growing dispensaries and delivery is going to be illegal in Newport Beach under a new ordinance. The city council voted Tuesday to approve the first reading of an ordinance banning the cultivation, processing, distribution, and delivery of cannabis in the city. The council commended law enforcement's work in crafting the ordinance. Of course, it's law enforcement to craft this. If you leave anything up to law enforcement when it comes to cannabis, craft it as an ordinance, you better kiss your ass goodbye. See ya. My mind just exploded right there thinking, like, God, I can't imagine if we didn't have people here in Colorado and in Denver to fight police organizations and the angry soccer moms. Dear God, we might be living in one of the best places in the United States, but it'd be a living hell with so many restrictions. Thank God we don't have that. Councilman, we already read that. Newport Beach's municipal code previously did not address medical marijuana, though dispensaries have not been allowed to operate in the city, according to city manager. Though there have been no brick-and-mortar pot dispensaries in Newport Beach, several online services say they deliver to marijuana to people in the city. Still going to have people being delivered marijuana in the city. The ban is response to the state's Medical Marijuana Regulation and Safety Act, which we just talked about. In the last story, municipalities having some time up into 2016 to be able to make their own rules. Otherwise, leaving it completely up to the state's regulatory agency to make all the rules for you. In 96, Prop 215 came into the picture, which enabled seriously ill Californians under the care of a doctor to legally possess, use, and cultivate marijuana. 2003, state legislature adopted the medical marijuana program, which allowed patients to associate collectively to cultivate marijuana for medical purposes. Several neighborhood cities have struggled for years with the notion of whether to allow pot shops in Costa Mesa, where medical marijuana dispensaries have been banned since 05. Two certified petitions sought to end the question. No, not end the question. Send the question to voters. Slow down, John Doe. Where was I at? But the city council declined to put them on a special election ballot this year because of technicalities in the state tax law. Instead, the petitions will be on the city's next general election ballot in November 2016. According to Newport Beach staff report, several Californian cities have reported offensive odors, illegal sales and distribution, trespassing, theft, violent robberies, fire hazards, and other problems related to the cultivation and distribution of marijuana. In other words, aka a brand new industry. Nothing is going to be perfect. Say you open a mini mall or an actual big mall that you walk into. Bunch of brand new stores in there. You think people are not going to shoplift from some of those stores? Not going to abuse that situation of having these fantastic, nice open stores? You get access to whatever product you're looking for a little bit easier. Some people are going to take advantage of that. So why would we think that people are not going to take advantage of this brand new industry where tons of money is being dumped into? It's to be expected. We are not a perfect society. We are not people that are exempt from just putting positive thoughts into things and then bam, it's positive. There's no bad. It's ridiculous and it's stupid to think of it in any other way other than this is a growing brand new industry that has the same kind of hiccups that any other industry would. In a letter to the city council, talking about Newport Beach still here, Joseph Stack wrote about the benefits of medical marijuana and who and what kind of benefits they've had to an ill family member living in another city. She's been able to get off a number of medications that have been much worse for side effects. He cautioned the council to keep those people in mind when you consider our ordinances. They don't care about that. Goes on to talk about how legitimate patients should be able to benefit from medical marijuana. And the city shouldn't opt out of that. Of course we know that. Stupid that they do. Farkers. Governor Cuomo signs two bills to speed up medical marijuana distribution. Governor Cuomo Wednesday signed two bills to establish an emergency medical marijuana program for qualified patients 2 months before the planned debut of a statewide program providing for medical use of the drug. Governor's signature effectively accelerates the first distribution of medical marijuana in the state since the passage of a 2014 law that added New York to the list of nearly two dozen other states where the drug is now available for sick patients. Under the bills passed earlier this year, the state health department is to set up a separate program to create an expedited pathway to qualified patients whose lack of access to the drug would pose a serious risk to their lives. Excuse me. Water indigestion. Mr. Cuomo, a Democrat, said in a statement accompanying his signatures that he deeply sympathized with New Yorkers suffering from serious illnesses, and I appreciate that medical marijuana may alleviate their chronic pain and debilitating symptoms. The governor did not initially embrace the bill, saying around the time of their passage that they would simply be reviewed. On Wednesday, however, he had clearly made up his mind. State legislature passed Compassionate Care Act during the legislative session of 2014. Mr. Cuomo agreed to sign the bill after insisting on a series of safeguards that would allow the state police and the health department extensive oversight of the drug's distribution. The law set an 18-month timetable for the program to begin, but advocates, including Assemblyman Richard Gottfried, a Manhattan Democrat, had pressed for a quicker timetable for the drug, a campaign that included a heartbreaking testimony in the halls of the state capitol from parents whose critically ill children clearly needed the access and were clearly suffering. In June, both houses of the legislature passed bills allowing for expedited use of marijuana for patients whose serious condition is progressive and degenerative and who were in danger of dying without prompt use of marijuana, which can be used to alleviate pain and increase appetite. 2014 law called for five organizations to produce the drug and distribute it through 20 dispensaries statewide. The bills that Mr. Cuomo signed call for an additional organization to produce the drug as soon as practicable, and to waive the tight controls of the Compassionate Care Act. When they talk about organization, they're talking about a business. The governor said that he was cognizant of restrictions on marijuana at a federal level where the drug is still considered illegal and asked that new emergency program abide by 2013 guidelines sent down by the United States Justice Department. In a statement, Mr. Gottfried praised the governor's action to speed up production and distribution of medical marijuana in the state, saying that a matter of days can be a matter of life or death for seriously ill patients. Governor Cuomo, the assemblyman has said, has done a very good deed. It's so good. By the way, if you are live in chat with us, you are listening,
like Rob, how do you say your name? Robaba? Is that Robaba 89? What are you playing? Final Fantasy 10? Is that what you're saying? Oh, by one, he's watching on his second screen, dabbing out and playing FFX. I assume that's Final Fantasy 10. Shout out to all my gamers out there. Probably lacking the live audience because they're all stuck on Fallout 4 right now. Fallout 4. I gotta get that game. No hate for the Fallout 4. Next story. This is an interesting topic that I ran into earlier today. I saw this story about HelloMD, and as I was skimming through it, this dude, is talking about how... Why don't we just read it? One morning in September, I logged on to the website of HelloMD. This dude's name is like Farhad Manju. I think I got close to his name right there. Farhad Manju. A medical startup, HelloMD, is that promises to connect patients with doctors instantly over the internet. He filled out his personal details, explained his ailment, and said that he often got heartburn and entered in my credit card number to cover the $50 consultation fee. Within 10 minutes, a pediatrician based near Washington, D.C., pediatrician, who is licensed to practice medicine in California, popped up on my screen. She appeared to be sitting in her home. There were a few teddy bears and ceramic figurines on a cabinet behind her, and she wore a red t-shirt, not the traditional white coat. Doctor then asked about the medical history that this dude had, current symptoms, and familiarity with certain medicines. I make it worse than it really is. Sorry. The interview lasted about 3 minutes, after which she announced that what everyone who visits HelloMD expects to hear. According to her diagnosis, my heartburn made me a candidate for medical marijuana, which has been legal, obviously, in California since 96. HelloMD is at the forefront of a new trend in Silicon Valley, the cannabis tech startup. As marijuana laws are being loosened across the country, entrepreneurs and investors are creating new businesses to cash in on what they see as an emerging bonanza. Like startups in other industries, these firms are trying to use technology to bring speed and efficiency to what has long been a face-to-face pen and paper market. In the process, they are also trying to alter mainstream perception of the marijuana industry, shedding the ganja and Rasta imagery to cultivate a wider audience. By the way, shout out to everybody in Jamaica right now. Super fucking jealous of you. What we see is moms, dads, professionals, old people, everyone wanting to access cannabis. The founder of HelloMD said, the old type of experience, go to a crummy dispensary, wait in line, was not going to appeal to the market that we were after, which is everyday Americans, a market that, by the way, is much larger than the old market of, I don't want to call them stoners, but let's say recreationally minded young people. Here in Denver, we see those non-wooks, is really what I call them when it comes down to it. Non-wooks are everywhere in Denver. There's also a large population of wooks. They get together quite fantastically. They work together quite fantastically. No real huge problems with wook-on-wook violence or public-on-wook violence. Just not happening necessarily here. Maybe when it comes to driving on I-25 or on the highway during rush hour, people are cussing out the wooks and the 200,000 people that moved here to Colorado in the last year. Maybe at that point in time, they're cussing them out. Maybe when they go to renew their rent, they're cussing them out. But in day-to-day get-togethers, just passing on the street, we don't seem to have too much violence or too much hate. And in fact, that dude you just passed on the sidewalk who looks like a businessman is all he wants to do is go home and smoke his doobie. Go home, sit down with his $10,000 mothership, and smoke his $60 a gram hash from Green Dot or Incredibles Extracts, turn on some sort of movie, turn on the news, turn on the Wall Street numbers, maybe grab a glass of scotch,
Scotch.
Whiskey, whatever it is. Generally here in Colorado, it's whiskey. I don't remember last time I saw somebody drinking scotch. And really, the only time I probably ever drank scotch was when there was nothing else to drink, which, why not drink it then? So we're doing just fine in the separation between the business people and the wooks here. So all this person's trying to do is just say that their idea of a business has a market to it. And assuming that people that are business-minded or non-wooks are not going to go into these shitty dispensaries that look like somebody's dorm room at a college. So we kind of moved past that here in Colorado. You don't really go into dispensaries and see the dorm room atmosphere. Like, for instance, our sponsor coming on board here, Ajoya. You walk in there, it looks like an Apple store. Super clean, super awesome. Great product. Super friendly people. And super laid back, which is how we like it here in Colorado. Jeans and a button-up shirt with a cowboy hat is considered formal wear here in the Mile High State. Especially like I was talking about earlier, up in the mountains. If you're in the mountains, you're going to any city council meeting, you see your city councilors, your county commissioners, whoever it is, most of the time dudes are wearing jeans and a tucked-in button-up shirt with a collar. Because that's just how we roll here in Colorado. Forget the suit and tie. Who the hell needs that shit? Are you bothered with that crap? Actually, I do like getting dressed up in a suit and tie. It looks snazzy. And luckily, the ladies don't necessarily want you to dress up in the suit and tie. And the beard situation. Mountain men situation. Not a wook situation, okay? As you can see, if you're watching this live here or whatever, my beard nicely trimmed. It's not something that goes down all the way down to my chest, which if you do have a beard that goes all the way down to your chest, as long as you keep it nicely trimmed, smells good, you're using oil, and there isn't feces in your beard, I think you're doing fine. You do pass some of the wooks that look like they're a little homeless. It does happen. What am I talking about? People in the marijuana industry have lately taken to saying that legal marijuana is the next internet, an untrammeled new... I don't know who's saying legal marijuana is the next internet, but this news story is. An untrammeled... I've never even heard this word before. Untrammeled. U-N-T-R-A-M-M-E-L-E-D. Trammeled. New market. Opportunity that is just waiting for its own big brands, the Google and Facebook, a pot. Did they make up that word, untrammeled? I think they just... Parker made that word up out from nowhere. I'm kidding. But many businesses are also finding that in an environment of only partial legality, not everything in the marijuana business is smooth sailing. Proponents for legalization expect a handful of states to vote on ballot measures to legalize the recreational use of marijuana in 2016. Biggest prize is California, where a wealthy coalition of advocates, including Sean Parker, the co-founder of Napster, and the former president of Facebook, is pushing for recreational legalization. I haven't got a chance to check out Sean Parker's legislation that he's introduced, but I have read over Reform CA and CCHI and a few others. Only one out of that group that I've mentioned that it all makes sense and it has any bit of worth of passing is Reform CA. Not a bad set of words put down on a paper that govern a certain type of situation, I must say. So I'll get into Sean Parker's here, start to read up on that so I can give back some good information to you guys. California is the biggest domino, said the founder and chief executive of Weedmaps, who makes a ton of money. Maps makes like $3 million plus a month in just advertising, in just dispensaries, paying them to put them on the front page or paying them to have their search results come up when you type in, I need weed in California. Boom. Pay to play, baby. Weedmaps also backing the California initiative. Once California goes legal, very shortly after, we'll have a majority of states where adult use is legal, says this person. I don't think that's necessarily true. I think that it may be possible that we see federal intervention, whether it's to knock it down or to open it up to everybody, rescheduling of cannabis, doing away with cannabis laws, and forming some sort of federal rules and regulation for it, I think we may be closer to that than seeing a majority of states pass legalization. I think that idea comes from people that are trying to beat the rest of the states to the punch and not have things get out of hand, quote unquote, out of hand, like they did with medical marijuana. Look at how many states we got to legalize medical marijuana. This shit is just out of hand. We can't handle this anymore. Those type of people come into the table. I think that we really do stand a chance of the feds running that gamut before the rest of the states get a chance to put it into play. And that's worrisome for people here in Colorado. It's worrisome for people in Washington because federal law would supersede what we've done here locally. So depending on if, which I can see the feds doing this, allowing states to be quote-unquote type dry states with alcohol prohibition, once that ended, still to this day, counties here in the United States, throughout the United States, who are dry counties that don't actually sell alcohol, same kind of thing's going to happen when it comes down to cannabis when it hits the federal level. I don't see any way possible, it not including a situation to where your state can opt out to it. And then, even if your state has opted in, hopefully we have decent regulations for people being able to be open. Hopefully the feds do leave it up more to the states, local municipalities, to make those rules. So, best case scenario, not much would change here in Colorado, and the feds would leave it up to us, leave it up to California, whoever it is. Worst case scenario, they wipe out everything. And we end up with a situation going on in like New Jersey or New York, where it's super restricted. By the way, if you're in Oklahoma, you should move. I forgot to mention that the last couple of days. And as our daily public service to you in the Oklahoma area, get the fuck out. Legalization will lead to continued growth of at least double-digit percentage points for the rest of the decade, according to Troy Dayton, the chief executive of ArcView Group. And he's talking about $2.4 billion in sales is an estimate in 2014, up 74% from 2013. And that's the American legal cannabis industry altogether. This is already the fastest growing industry in America, and when these markets come online, the impact will be huge. I can't even... The numbers that California is going to produce when it comes down to cannabis, the numbers they already produce but are off the books, astounding. Such big numbers. When millions of new customers flood into the marijuana businesses, tech companies will be lining up to offer them an easy way to find a hit. They've already made it pretty simple. After getting his prescription, he didn't have to do much more to get some drugs. HelloMD emailed him a letter saying, here's your medical marijuana recommendation, which is the technical equivalent of a medical marijuana prescription, stating that this patient has been diagnosed with a serious medical condition and medical use of marijuana is appropriate. Using Weed Maps, he found a service that would deliver marijuana to his house. After uploading a picture of my driver's license and the Hello MD letter to the dispensary, he was cleared to order from a... This dude has quite a vocabulary. Voluminous online menu. He chose Shatter Tank, $100 pen-shaped electronic cannabis extract vaporizer. Even when it comes to drugs, I choose the techie route, he said. After about an hour placing his order, a young man who bore the faint smell of a joint rang my doorbell and handed me the package. The entire process was easier than ordering a pizza. Except for having to scan your driver's license and your recommendation that you can eat that pizza to whoever you're ordering it from. He's since forgotten about his heartburn, which he really does have, though of course it's entirely possible that many HelloMD patients could be stretching the truth about their ailments. HelloMD is not alone. On Wednesday, Meadow, a one-year-old company that also makes it easy to get prescriptions and order online, is announcing the introduction of a software that will eventually let many businesses in the medical marijuana supply chain manage their operations digitally. Kind of like what's happening here in Colorado with the regulation system. I just brain farted what the name of that system was. Oh, Metric. M-E-T-R-C, I think is what it's called. But that tracks everything from seed to sale. So anything technically that's in the legal cannabis market is supposed to be in this database. And I guess you could probably develop some sort of software. Not I guess, you can develop some sort of software off of that to be able to manage your supply in the stores that you have. One other thing that just keeps blowing me away and may become an issue here coming up in this November election is that liquor here in Colorado, liquor stores are only allowed to have one liquor license. So I also found out something else, because you go to stores here in Colorado like King Supers, supermarkets, 7-Eleven, whatever it is, you go inside there and they only have 3-2 beer, because that's all you could sell without having an actual, you know, liquor license or a hard liquor license to sell harder, whatever. But there are a few, like there's one, only one store can hold that liquor license to be able to sell full strength alcohol. So you go, I think it's up north, one King Supers that has it. There's one Walmart here in the state that sells a wide range of alcohol. But that's the difference, that cannabis didn't implement that type of rule. You can, unless you're in Denver, have as many permits, have as many licenses as possible. So you can stack a huge conglomerate when everything gets said and done in opening these businesses. Liquor industry probably going to use that as an example in the coming months and up to November of next year to be able to get this. I don't know how many times they've tried to do it, like 10 times, try and get full strength alcohol, multi liquor licenses, liquor stores. Say you go down to the corner liquor store, that dude's the only dude, that's the only liquor store that he owns. This is the only liquor store that he's allowed to own in the state. Anyway, that's neither here nor there. It's just the cannabis industry is going to be used as an example to why are we still limiting businessmen from opening multiple stores. It's also a big reason why we have some of the biggest fucking liquor stores in the entire world here in Denver and around in Colorado. Yada, yada, yada. Meadow has received funding from so-and-so, blah, 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 blah. In April, founders fund the venture capital film, a firm co-founded by investor Peter Thiel, made a multi-million dollar investment into Private Holdings, a Seattle company that manages several marijuana businesses. Among privateers' companies is Leafly, which is one of the most ridiculously non-on-point accurate websites you can go to for any type of cannabis information. I think they just have a bunch of stoners running around in a closed room playing video games, writing news stories for how they feel the news story should go. It's like, oh, that's not really the case. Ah, fuck it. This is how it should be. And then their news story comes out. That's why we never read news stories from Leafly here on JDR. Anyway, article goes on and on and on and on. Basically talks about how the tech industry is breaking into cannabis. If you can design computer programs, if you can design software, it would be huge if you designed software that would go to help manage dispensaries and shops, not only their employee workforce, but big time, obviously, the inventory that they have. Alerts being sent out. We're getting low on the Scentsy Star. The top shelf Scentsy Star is getting low. Needs to be refilled. All right, getting down to it. One more story. All right, we'll leave you with the... Which one do I want to leave you with? Weed Wars. That's too negative of a story. Okay, let's leave on a down note. Driver shot on US 85 in Boulder. The armed robbery suspect who led police on a chase in Boulder County Tuesday here in Colorado was shot and killed by police in Brighton just 12 hours later. Boulder County Sheriff's Office Commander Heidi Prentup confirmed the man killed was suspected of assaulting and robbing a 45-year-old man at the home in Sunrise Canyon in Boulder. According to authorities, two men entered the home. At least one was armed with a handgun. The two men demanded marijuana from the resident, who did not give them any. One of the suspects reportedly fired a handgun into the couch. Then a suspect pistol-whipped the man, took an unknown amount of marijuana, and took off in a white Chevy Suburban. One of the suspects was identified by a license plate on the Suburban. What a jackass. Yeah, use your own vehicle for an armed robbery. Deputies got an arrest warrant for the Adams County residents for second-degree assault and aggravated robbery. When they arrived at the Adams County home at 7:30, they seized the Suburban driven by an armed robbery suspect, but did not find him there. Later in the day, Longmont police spotted a vehicle matching the description and initiated matching a description of... They kind of skip here. They had gotten reports of another vehicle that this person was involved with, so they found that vehicle. Pursuit initiated around 9 p.m. The Adams County Sheriff's Department, Colorado State Patrol, and Brighton Police helped with the chase. Stop sticks and multiple pit maneuvers were used to disable the vehicle. Late Tuesday night, two other cars were hit during the chase. Law enforcement officers saw the man had a weapon. Officers fired at him, and he was pronounced dead at the scene. If you get shot at by cops, there's a pretty damn good chance you're going to die because they are taught to literally empty their clip. Just keep firing. If they shoot at you, they're trying to kill you. It's not trying to stop you or... Well, I guess it is trying to stop you because they're trying to kill you. Not trying to, like, warn you to say, hey, I'm going to shoot you in your leg. No, they're trying to kill you. And they're trained to kill you. Additional circumstances regarding the shooting not currently available to investigators as they continue the investigation. So, a couple days with some horrible cannabis news stories. But, like I've said, the positive note on these news stories is that it's not necessarily marijuana being blamed as the reason why these are happening. It's more of the people that involved with it are shitty people doing shitty things. And so there we go. It is disappointing, though, because even if people in the public hear, you know, the headline is... I mean, the headline on 9 News, the headline on the Denver Post is driver shot on US 85 involved in Boulder armed robbery. That used to be driver shot on US 85 involved in marijuana robbery. Would have had pot somewhere in the headline, but since we're making movement here, since it's becoming part of our culture here in Colorado, the norm, we don't see that as a headline. And that's fantastic. It should be something on the bright side. Obviously, if you're this dude that got pistol whipped, it's not a bright side for you. Can you imagine being robbed, somebody pointing a gun at you, and you saying, go fark your couch? That takes some cojones, man. Kiss my ass. I grew this weed. Falls on the ground. Hopefully that doesn't happen more and more. Anyway, have yourself a fantastic day. That's going to do it for JDR News Live today. Big thanks to the sponsors that make this show possible. If you do not get a chance to catch us live, or if you're catching us late, you would like to listen to the rest of the JDR, make sure you head to johndorad.io, johndorad.io, and holler at Bike. Tell Bike, we miss you. We need you here. It's fun just sitting here talking to myself, talking to you guys. It's even funner when we have somebody to catch the mistakes, to give me shit, to give their own personal feedback, having another mind in here. Believe me, I don't want it just being me to sit down and talk to you, ramble on here for an hour every single day, or 3 hours if Mike does eventually join us again here on the JDR. Jesus, I used to do 3 hours of just talking to myself. Not the hardest thing in the world to do because, you know, I'm kind of full of a lot of hot air. But if you have another person there, you turn and look at the clock and you're like, damn, it's only felt like 10 minutes. We're already done with this thing. Anyway, thanks to our sponsors, the John Doe Radio Show, WeedBiz.net, USACannabisConsulting.com, JDR News Live brought to you by USACannabisConsulting.com and YourGraphics.com. Sawdite. Have yourself a fantastic day. Try and stay warm if you're anywhere where it is kind of chilly. Say Colorado. It's supposed to be pretty warm tomorrow, but this wind when you walk outside is blistering cold. That's probably the next thing I got to do. Go stand outside with a dog while she shivers and is scared of the wind. Good times. If you got anything else you'd like to give us on the John Doe Radio Show, suggestions, comments, whatever it is, holler at me on Facebook, Tim Martin, or you can holler at Michael Hawley on Facebook, too. Cannabis concierge himself. Until we meet again tomorrow, have a fantastic evening, fantastic day. I'm Tim Martin. See ya.
which is not really deep, but includes information and agriculture subjects.
It is intended as informational and entertainment purposes only. We specifically include responsible marijuana reform.
Listening to anyone but your mother has just been stupid.
We accept no responsibility for your actions or misrepresentations, and we do not fully endorse the use of illegal drugs. You are ultimately responsible for yourself.
Live.